Everyone, in this video I wanted to talk about logistic regression and kind of go over the basics of how logistic regression works. So I'm going to start by comparing it to a typical linear model, which would be multiple linear regression or simple linear regression, which is when you have a variable y, which is your outcome variable, and you regress y on one or more predictor variables. So I'm just going to say as an example x1, x2, x3. So this could be any number of predictor variables. In this type of linear model, x1, x2, x3, and y are all continuous random variables. So that means that the values of y and all the x's can be any number. These values, when they're continuous, can exist anywhere from negative infinity to infinity. And so when you have a linear model where your outcome variable y is continuous and your predictor variables are continuous, the model, the linear regression model, is basically that y is equal to a linear combination of the predictor variables. So you're going to have, in this example, a model like this, where y is equal to a linear combination of the x's, and because the x's are continuous, this can exist anywhere from negative infinity to infinity on the right-hand side, and on the left-hand side, a linear combination of terms that can exist from negative infinity to infinity also has the same domain, so it can also exist from negative infinity to infinity. When you're doing logistic regression, you're going to have a slightly different type of model. The idea with logistic regression is that instead of having a continuous random variable y, the outcome variable is now going to be categorical. Theoretically, for a logistic regression, there's such a thing as multinomial regression, where y could be any number of levels. But usually when we're talking about the basics of logistic regression, we're just going to consider y as a binomial random variable. So y can have two outcomes. This could be any categorical variable with any levels. So for example, it could be gender, where the outcome could be male, female. So that's one possible outcome variable. The outcome could be yes, no. It could be disease, no disease. So I'm just giving examples of categorical variables that could be your outcome variable y. And mathematically, when we do a logistic regression model, we're just going to model the categorical variable as 0, 1. The number 0 is going to refer to some level, and the number 1 is going to refer to the other level. And so this is how you would write out mathematically a binomial random variable. So we see from the linear model that we had before, on our right-hand side, the predictor variables are still going to be continuous. So on the right-hand side, these values can still exist anywhere from negative infinity to infinity, but when we change the outcome variable to only be equal to either 0 or 1, now we have a problem where the left-hand side does not equal the domain of the right-hand side. We can't just use a linear regression model to predict an outcome variable that's categorical. And this is basically where the idea of logistic regression comes in. So we have to transform the left-hand side, which is the outcome variable, to have the range of negative infinity to infinity. So the way logistic regression solves this problem is that instead of predicting y as 0 or 1, we're going to predict on the left-hand side the probability that y is equal to 1. So since y can take on either the value 0 or 1, we're going to say we want to model the probability that y is equal to 1. And again, we're going to regress this on the predictor variables. I'm going to label the probability as lowercase p, and the probability of any probability can be between the values of 0 and 1 inclusive. So now instead of just having two possible values on the left-hand side, now we have an infinite number of possible values that can range from 0 to 1. But this still doesn't completely solve the problem because we can't go less than 0 or more than 1. Whereas on the right-hand side, we still can be anywhere from negative infinity to infinity. So we still have to do a transformation on the probability that y is equal to 1 to get it to a range of negative infinity to infinity. So the way logistic regression does that is the left-hand side is going to be equal to the log of p over 1 minus p. And so this is known as the log odds of the probability that y is equal to 1. So a probability over 1 minus the probability, that's known as the odds. That's the equation for an odds. So we're taking the log odds of p, which is the probability that y is equal to 1. And this is the model that's known as logistic regression. So this is your left-hand side, and then that's equal to a linear combination of the predictor variables. And this equation is known as logistic regression. This transformation that we do on P, the probability that y is equal to 1, we do it basically now because the log odds of the probability that y is equal to 1 does have the desired range, which is from negative infinity to infinity. So basically, when we graph out what the logistic model looks like, a logistic regression basically models an S-shaped curve. So a logistic curve is also known as an S-shaped curve. And basically what's going to happen is if you have very large values on your right-hand side, so your linear combination is very large, what that's going to do is this is going to go to 1 and this approaches 0. So if you have large predictor values, the linear combination of that is basically going to predict observations that have a probability close to 1. And on the other hand, if you have very small values, the linear combination is going to predict probabilities that approach 0. And then there are a few probabilities in between that are in between 0 and 1. And so this is the idea of logistic regression in a nutshell. And then if you're using logistic regression to predict an outcome variable, so if you want to predict whether y is 0 or 1, the final step is you're going to have some kind of probability cutoff. So I'm going to write that as p alpha. So let's say the probability cutoff is 0.5. So the way we use the probability cutoff is we are going to predict the probability that y is equal to 1. And so if that is greater than or equal to the probability cutoff, then that means that we're going to label y as 1. So let's say using our logistic regression model, we find that the probability that y is equal to 1 is equal to 0.56. If our probability cutoff is 0.5, then that means because 0.56 is greater than 0.5, we're going to label that observation as y is equal to 1, or that outcome as y is equal to 1. Probability cutoff is something that you can pick as the statistician. So you can have, for example, a high probability cutoff. You can say, I only want to label y as equal to 1 if the probability that y is equal to 1 is 0.9 or greater. So you might only want to label y as equal to 1 if you're really, really sure. What you pick as your probability cutoff, it's going to affect things like the sensitivity of the model or the specificity of the model and also the accuracy. So that's something that you can play around with to try to maximize whatever diagnostic metric you want to use to pick a good model. And one last thing I want to know about the logistic regression before I move on to an example is that you can see that once we do the transformation on the left-hand side, we do get that the left-hand side is equal to a linear combination of terms on the right-hand side. So this is not considered directly a linear model, but it belongs to a family of models known as GLMs or generalized linear models. So this is a type of model where if you have a function of an outcome variable equal to a linear combination of terms, that's known as a generalized linear model. So it's basically like a special type of linear model where you have to have some kind of function on the left-hand side. And in the last part of the video, I just want to do this example problem. So in this problem, we're given an equation for a logistic regression, and it has two predictor variables, x1, x2. Then we're given the values of x1 and x2. We're asked to calculate the probability that y is equal to 1, and then with that probability, classify y as equal to 0 or 1 using the probability cutoff of 0.5. So for this type of problem, and you might do this in a computer, but basically the way that you solve for p, which is equal to the probability that y is equal to 1, this is always the same formula. So I'll go ahead and derive it in this video, but this formula is basically going to be e to the linear combination of terms, b0 plus b1 x1 plus dot 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 bm xm over 1 plus e to the linear combination of terms. So b0 plus b1 x1 plus dot 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 bm xm. And so this is always going to be the formula for this type of problem to solve for the probability. And again, if you're doing logistic regression on a computer, this is basically how the computer is calculating these probabilities. But let me go ahead and solve this problem and show you how I come to that formula. So I'm going to first plug in x1 and x2 into the equation. So then we're just going to have to solve for p, and we're going to have numbers for all the other values. So on the left-hand side, that's going to be the log of the odds of the probability, which is p over 1 minus p, is equal to negative 1.55 plus 0.73 times negative 0.9 minus 3.11 times negative 0.77. this entire equation, if we add and subtract everything, is going to be equal to 0.1877. When we say we take the log odds, this is usually assumed to be a base of e, so it's usually assumed to be the natural log. So to get rid of the log on the left-hand side, I'm going to take e to the both sides, the left-hand side and the right-hand side of the equation. That's going to give me on the left-hand side p over 1 minus p, and then the right-hand side is going to be e to the 0.1877. I'm going to multiply both sides by the denominator, so I'm going to multiply by 1 minus p. So that's going to give me p is equal to 1 minus p times e to the 0.1877. I'm going to distribute the e to the 0.1877. So that's going to give me e to the 0.1877 minus p times e to the 0.1877 is equal to p. I want to solve for p, so I'm going to add this term to both sides. So that's going to give me p plus p times e to the 0.1877 is equal to e to the 0.1877. And then I'm going to draw out the p. So that's going to be equal to p times 1 plus e to the 0.1877 is equal to e to the 0.1877. And to solve for p, I'm going to divide both sides by this term. So that's going to give me p is equal to e to the 0.1877 divided by 1 plus e to the 0.1877. So that's how you solve this particular equation, but again, in general, the way the formula always is it's going to be e to the linear combination of terms over 1 plus e to the linear combination of terms. When I actually solve for this number, that's going to equal approximately 0.5468. Since we have in the problem that the probability cutoff p alpha is equal to 0.5, and because the probability p is 0.5468, since p is greater than the probability cutoff, we're going to classify y as equal to 1. And we are done with this problem.